Next question is, can health be addictive? And Dr. Joseph Kvedar will address that question. Dr. Joseph Kvedar is founder and director of the Center for Connected Health at Partners Healthcare. He's leveraging cell phones, computers, and remote health monitoring tools to improve health delivery. Dr. Kvedar established the first physician-to-physician online consultation service, linking patients from around the world with specialists at Harvard-affiliated teaching hospitals. Based on the technology platform developed at the center, HealthRages, a personalized health technology company, was launched in 2010. And Dr. Kvedar is a co-founder and chair of the company's scientific board. He is internationally recognized for his leadership and vision in the field of connected health and authored over 90 publications on the subject. And the next chapter is to make health addictive. Welcome.
Thanks. Well, it's not so crazy, actually, to think about this concept of addictive health. It started out for me when I was riding in one morning listening to NPR, and I heard an article about this phenomenon, that we're addicted to our mobile phones. There's a few phone checkers in the audience here right now. And in fact, when I talk, I usually find these days that I'm sharing attention with multiple different screens. People can't seem to put their phones down, and by some estimates, we check them 100 times a day. Some people say 150. Whatever it is, that's a lot of attention paid to your mobile device. And that really intrigued me because where I work at the Center for Connected Health, we sort of occasionally run into the opposite problem, which is illustrated here. This is from one of the programs that we run at our center, and it's a program for blood pressure control called Blood Pressure Connect. A patient uses a blood pressure cuff and a home hub device. The idea about the hub is it gets the information out of the cuff and into the cloud so that we can do interesting things with it, like care better for the patient, help them understand their condition, et cetera. So the hub's very important, and we've had a mixed environment of those hubs for a while. It's actually one of the areas of connected health technology that's rapidly changing. And you see two of them pictured here. The one on the left is no longer, I think, in production, but at the time, it was a device where you plugged in the blood pressure cuff and you pushed that little blue button and off goes your blood pressure data to us. The one on the right, it has a version that's still in production and it's called the HealthPal. But what's different about this one is you don't have to push any buttons. You take your blood pressure, it automatically winds up in our database. And when we looked at this, because we had both of these out in the environment, we compared the two cohorts of patients using them. The people who had to push a button had less engagement, that is to say they uploaded less often, and they had poorer outcomes. So it's interesting to me that you check your smartphone 150 times a day, but I can't get you to push a button once to do something to improve your health. And I really started thinking about that, and it occurred to me that maybe we're going at it the wrong way. Maybe that says more about the way we're asking you to improve your health than you're not wanting to push a button. And that's really what I've been thinking about. That's what the talk is about, and it's by no means is this sort of the cement is dry in this concept. It's still very, very much information. So your interest, your dialogue, your comments would be most welcome after I go through it. So is mobility and health a big deal? It certainly is the hot topic right now. It's sort of all the rage and to the point where we kind of get tired, I think, of hearing about it. But I actually do think it's a game changer. I think it is, in fact, a really big deal. For a number of reasons. One, it's this idea of always on, always connected. If you think about healthcare delivery, we've never had a time in history where we could have a device in the palm of your hand, I'm talking about you, the patient now, that's always on, is always connected, and that means we can message you in the moment when it's most needed, when you need to get something done that's relevant to your health. I can get in your path, as it were, because you're carrying this always on, always connected device. That's pretty interesting of it in and of itself. Now, there's also this phenomenon that we can collect all kinds of interesting things about you using the mobile phone. You can, of course, take pictures of things between skin lesions and rashes, or tests that you might do in your home. Take a picture of a urine test or a test that you might run in the privacy of your home, email it to someone for evaluation. The sensors in the phone, of course, the GPS, the accelerometer, all have the opportunity to gather interesting data about you, and then the Bluetooth radio sending out and collecting data from these various sensors it will have on your body area network. So there's a lot of opportunity there that's unprecedented as well. And of course, it can display information. So these are all pretty powerful and pretty exciting, and you see a lot of innovation going on right now in all of those areas in healthcare delivery using mobile technology. But I actually think they're all dwarfed by this phenomenon, and we haven't yet really been able to attack this one, this idea that these things are addictive. And if they're so powerfully addictive, I keep wondering, is there a way that I can get my health message in front of you when you're opening the darn thing 150 times a day? And by doing that, I will almost certainly change your behavior if I can do it in a way that's non-intrusive and relevant and so forth. And that's really what I want to talk to you about for the remainder of my time on the podium. You get this kind of thing. Again, we've made the point that phones are addictive. All this behavior. And there's another fun anecdote from, I think it was Sydney, Australia, where a person who was checking their Facebook fell into the water. And the police then come up with this headline that says, individuals checking social media should not do so near the water. Kind of interesting. I mean, what are the other things you might do with your phone? You can do that near the water, I guess. In any event, they are addictive. So how do we turn that into health? How do we turn that into something that's more health-oriented? And I've thought of three strategies and three tactics. And as I said, this is the part where it's still very much formative, my thinking. But for each one of these, I have some examples. And in most cases, all but one, actually, I have an example from work at our center that can illustrate the power of this either strategy or tactic. So let's start with strategy number one, make it about life. As a healthcare professional, I don't know how many other healthcare professionals there are in here, but we often get patients, I was just with patients this morning, which is why I couldn't join you this morning, and they always come in, I'm a dermatologist, they say, don't yell at me because I have a sunburn. I've never yelled at a person, I've been practicing 30 years. But there's this notion that the doctor is somehow lecturing at you. Now, we cause that. That's the way we communicate with people. So we say things like, if you don't lose 10 pounds, you're going to get a heart attack. Or if you don't change your diet, you're going to get diabetes. And I submit to you that's not really effective messaging. Rather, what if we asked you what really matters to you? We all actually do want to be healthy. We want to feel good. No one wants to feel sick. Everyone wants to be healthy. But it comes out really in a different way. It comes out as things like, I want to fit into a certain dress to attend my daughter's wedding, or I want to be more active so I can spend time with my grandchildren. I want to have more energy to achieve my job. Whatever it is for you, that's what we should be thinking about. Now, here's an example from our own center, which is a program that we developed for text messaging in obstetrics, pregnancy. Now, if you think about it, if I know your due date, I can really predict a lot of things about you for about 7 months, and then a couple months postpartum. And all we did was set up this campaign. As you all know, if you do any work with campaigns, it's driven by dates and entries in a database. And the messages go out, and they're things like, don't forget to come in for your ultrasound, your baby should be kicking now, now's a good time to start shopping for your car seat, just all kinds of interesting little tidbits that are delivered by text message. And then to really make it, I think, more sticky, each message is fronted by, this is from your OB team, and then the message. Now, patients know when they sign up that these are coming from a server, but they come into their midwives and they say, thank you for sending me all these messages, because it's something that really is sticky for them. High, as you can see from the data, satisfaction with this service. So make it about life. Here's another one. Did you know that if I tell you your cardiac risk factor is 4.7, I don't know, that's kind of not meaningful, but if I say to you your heart age is, let's say, 10 years older than whatever you are, for me, let's say I'm 57, someone said, actually, Joe, your heart age is 70, that would get my attention, because that really says to me, I'm actually not taking very good care of myself. So even the American Heart Association is catching on to this notion of communicating with people in a language that's familiar to them, that's about life as opposed to about lecturing you about illness. Very important. So that's strategy number one. Number two is another favorite, make it personal. Now, this is really a takeoff from the advertising industry who these days, each one of us, every single person in this room, when you fire up your web browser, will get a different experience than the person next to you, because all of your digital breadcrumbs are being consumed on the back end and served up to you as tantalizing impulse purchase opportunities called ads. Well, gosh, if they can do it, can we do it in healthcare? And we have some evidence that we can. It's not as easy as making an impulse purchase, or I wouldn't be up in front of you. Getting you to do something healthy is a bigger challenge, but using some of the same tools and personalization tools, we think actually there's an opportunity. This is another program. This is another texting program that we just finished evaluating called Text to Move. It was for type 2 diabetes, and the persons enrolled got three kind of data streams coming from them that we collected. The first was an ongoing data stream asking them questions periodically about how motivated they are to be more active. We start with five questions based on the trans-theoretical model, and then we just keep, during the process, firing out every couple of weeks a new text message asking them about this variable. So that's a slowly changing variable. The middle is a smart pedometer, like a Fitbit or a Jawbone. We happen to use a different one, but that concept that it's a passively collecting activity data, which is what we want them to be, is more active. And the third is some electronic record data that we collect about their practice and so forth. So we mash all that up in an algorithm. Again, it's the kind of thing that Google would probably snicker at because it's three variables. But this is healthcare, and we have to start somewhere. And that algorithm generates twice a day contextual motivational text messages. If I'm not off the couch yet, it's going to be coaching me about opportunities to get off the couch and get a few hundred more steps a day in. If I'm already at 15,000 steps a day and maintaining, it's going to be coaching me very differently. And it takes into account things like the weather, so that if I know you're a good walker, but it's been raining for 2 days and you haven't really walked, I'll start giving you advice about how you can get some activity indoors. It's not me, it's the algorithm. So this is doing well for us. We just analyzed the data. People who were engaged with this did much better. They had a one percentage point drop in A1C. They were more active. So this is a start to a line of research that will get more and more complicated with more and more inputs and more sophisticated messaging, not involving a human being, which I think is interesting. So make it personal. Strategy three may be the one that trumps them all, social, reinforce social connections. The idea that social networks are important, we all know this. I'm sure all of you who have read Connected, Nicholas Christakis and James Fowler's book, and this is not news, that social connections are really important. Matter of fact, there's this other phenomenon that I'll tell you about in a few minutes called the sentinel effect, which is that we know that if you are being watched by someone you care about, you'll behave differently. So there's many components to the social phenomenon. That could be just group support, there could be coaching, there could be a lot of phenomena there. Matter of fact, we have just finished this as well. This is an interesting little study we've done with teenagers with asthma, asking the question if being part of a Facebook group could be therapeutic. independent of other variables. And it's actually quite dramatic. There's something called the asthma control test, which is a measure of asthma control. And kids are supposed to take it once a month. Average adherence, teenagers, right? Average adherence, about 20%. Being part of this Facebook group with no other changes in their variables, 70%. Better adherence, better everything, just by being part of a social group around asthma. Very powerful. So make it about, or rather, reinforce social connections. So those are the three strategies. Now the three tactics line up more or less with them. The first one is subliminal messaging. This is one that I can't think of a different way to call it. Actually, my colleagues back at the center kind of give me a hard time for this because it conjures up bad sort of advertising from when I was a kid and flashing things in front of you. What I really mean by this is this idea that if I can message you about something you care about and get your attention, I might be able to get my health message in sort of sub rosa. This is worth looking at, not just for the entertainment value, but for the fascination. I don't know how many of you have teenagers. If you have kids, you may have heard of the Truth Campaign. If you don't, you probably have not. It's funded by the American Legacy Foundation through this thing called the Truth Campaign. And they do all kinds of interesting, really, really cutting edge marketing ploys, all with the goal of educating kids that smoking is a bad idea without ever lecturing to them that they shouldn't smoke. So this particular one is pretty recent. It takes advantage of the idea that cigarette smoke has methane in it, which is in feces, and urea in it, which is in urine, and we're running a Twitter campaign with hashtags, which is more gross to you? And the kids are out there fighting over which is more gross, pee or poop. It's just pretty interesting that, you know, you're taking advantage of all those sort of sophomoric tendencies and what have you to drive home a message. Who would want to smoke at all with either, right? So that's the intent. And they do a lot of interesting stuff. It's all viral. It's all cutting edge. Well worth looking at. And I think we could use more of these tactics in getting your health messages home. This is an example from our group of a similar kind of thing. This is a study we did many years ago. And the idea behind this study was to encourage people to put on sunscreen. So this, even though I'm showing a picture of an iPhone here, this is pre-smartphone feature phones. And you may recall the day when you didn't have a weather app. That figures into the story. So we simply gave people a device to measure their sunscreen use, and then we asked them to use sunscreen every day. And the people in the intervention group had a once-a-day reminder text message to use their sunscreen. They also, it turns out, and this was almost an afterthought, that's why it's a fascinating story, but they also, in that message, the first thing that came up was a weather report. Today it's going to be 56 and partly cloudy. Don't forget to put on your sunscreen. Those were how the messages were designed. And you can see this top line is the people who were in the intervention. They had about a 60% adherence rate throughout the study. And then the other curve is the control group who did miserably. That's me telling people in the office, you probably should use sunscreen. That's my success rate without any messaging. But when we went back and asked these people what was compelling, they said, well, we love getting the weather report. Didn't think that much about sunscreen, to be honest with you, but we love getting the weather report. And so that's what I mean by subliminal messaging. If I can find something that's really interesting to you and then fit my message into it, I have a better shot. Even if you don't think you're reading it, it sticks, and this is evidence of that. The second one is unpredictable rewards. This is one I don't have an example from healthcare for, but the example I have is from the company Uber, which I'm sure all of you know. Good way to get a ride these days. But one of the things that Uber does is they, every now and then when you open their app, you'll get a little surprise, like an offer to get flowers for a discount or an offer for some other thing. And when they were asked about that, they said, well, we do that because we've proven that people open the app more often if they look for that. Even when they don't need a ride, they'll open it up to see if there's something waiting for them. So it's just this idea of unpredictable rewards. Really, B.F. Skinner proved this out 100 years or so ago when he did his operant conditioning experiments. So not news, but really interesting how you could think of applying that to health messaging. Unpredictable rewards. And the last one, as I mentioned, is the sentinel effect. That is this idea that if you know you're being watched, you act differently. And if you're being watched by someone that you feel is an authority figure or that you care about their opinion, you act a lot differently. This is one of the reasons we have these programs. I mentioned Blood Pressure Connect earlier. We have one called Diabetes Connect. Same kind of idea, uploading your glucose, getting feedback from a clinician, usually a nurse, about your condition based on those data. And these are the results from patients. They do really well. Both of those programs have been shown to be effective. They're both being scaled in our delivery system in the next fiscal year. Great success story. We asked the patients, what was it about this program that kept you engaged? I don't want to disappoint my doctor. I know someone in my doctor's office is reading, looking at the readings. Oh, by the way, they also said, if they stop looking, I'll probably stop participating because really I'm doing it for them. Again, it's this twisted logic of they're not doing it for their own livelihood, they're doing it to please the doctor or the nurse. I don't really care, but we have to take advantage of that, and that's the sentinel effect. So I've quickly gone through three strategies and three tactics. It's worth thinking about now, what might it look like when it's all put together? We're at the Future of Health Technology Symposium. What might this look like? I have a couple of examples. I don't know what it's going to look like. I think there's a real opportunity here for someone to do something interesting. This is one, though. This is Facebook Home. Facebook launched this, I think, just less than a year ago. The idea was you could, if you had an Android phone, download an app to your phone that would sort of take over your home screen. Whenever you pick up your phone and open it, instead of getting to email or text or whatever you might be looking for, you get to Facebook first. It didn't go over all that well, I guess because people think that's kind of controlling, but imagine if you had the opportunity to have your health plan offer you this in exchange for a premium discount, and it wasn't that intrusive, so every time you opened your phone, you saw a health-related message relevant to you, and you got a few thousand dollars a year off your premium as a result. That might be interesting. So someone will probably try something like that. We'll see. So that's one example. Google Field Trip is another. Guys, you guys know about this? This is a really interesting app. By the way, around here it's a blast because there's so many historical sites in the Boston-Cambridge area. But you download this thing and it runs in the background. It's using your GPS to map you against Google's map database. And when you come next to a building of interest, it buzzes or plays a sound, and you pick up your phone, and you get a nice little treatise on that building that's relevant to your interest. Think about doing that for health. If I know your activity level, I know your health status, I know your blood pressure, I know your blood glucose, and I know you're headed into McDonald's for a Big Mac, it's an opportunity for me to sort of flash something up that might help you go down the street to a more healthy meal, maybe. Just one example, but location-based services could be really powerful in this vision of this idea. So those are some ideas. It's, as I say, ill-formed. I do believe that we're missing the opportunity to really use mobile health in its best form by not taking advantage of this addictive nature of smartphones. We're working on it now at the center. It's going to take us a few years to figure it out. We would very much welcome your dialogue and your interest in the area. And I thank you for your time.